It's Michelle from Lab Muffin Beauty Science, Chemistry PhD and Skincare Nerd, and today I'm going to be talking about how to adapt your routine as you get older. I'm turning 34 this year and I'm starting to see some changes happen in my face, and if you're around the same age, you'll probably be noticing this as well. So I'm going to go through some of the things that you might do to your routine, some things that you might add, some things that you might take away as you get older. If you like talking nerdy about the science behind beauty products, click the like, the subscribe, and the notification bell so you don't miss any videos. Today's video is sponsored by Foreo, and I'm going to start by talking about microcurrent. This topic really highlights one of the things that I think is really important when deciding what to use, which is working out exactly what you're trying to address. When you get older, you start to see lots of changes in your face, and a lot of these don't have anything to do with skin. And so if you're using skincare products to try to address these, it's just not going to work. One of the big changes is sagging and drooping, and this is to do with things under your skin. This is to do with muscle, bone, and fat. So you'll start to see a general volume loss and a shift in the shape of your face. And unfortunately, you can't really fix this with skincare. It's too deep for skincare to effectively address. To change this, you generally need things like fillers and surgery, facelifts, Botox. So trying to change this with skincare just isn't going to work very well. If you see skincare that claims to help with sagging and drooping, it can help a little bit, but skin is only 2 millimeters thick, so you can improve that 2 millimeters, but if everything underneath is still changing, then it's going to be limited. I think a lot of us are pretty uncomfortable with these sorts of procedures. They're a bit more invasive, and I know I am a complete wuss when it comes to this sort of thing. So if you're a bit hesitant to go into this sort of procedural route, then one of the few things that you can do at home that will actually help is microcurrent. So this is the Foreo Bare. It is an at-home microcurrent device. I did a video on how microcurrent works and how to use the Foreo Bare, so check that out if you want more details. Microcurrent can make your face look more lifted, it changes how your muscles tense up, and it can give you the appearance of more volume. It doesn't seem to have much effect on fat and bone, but it does seem to increase your muscle volume, and volume is volume. You can generally see the effects pretty immediately, so the most obvious ones are usually in your cheeks, they become more lifted and more sculpted, and in your forehead as well. In general, the effect is going to be more dramatic if your face is starting to droop a bit. So if you're in your late teens or early 20s, then the effect you're going to see is probably going to be very limited. But from your mid to late 20s onwards, then you can start to really see that effect after just using it once. You use it for only 2 to 3 minutes a day, and the effect lasts for a few days. So you do have to keep on using it to maintain the look, and the more you use it, the more that effect builds up. I've seen some people say that because it's a temporary effect, it's not worth it, and I disagree. I think that perspective that something temporary, something that lasts a few days, isn't worth it comes mostly from people who don't wear makeup. I think people who use makeup regularly know that things that are more subtle, things that are temporary, can have a big effect on your appearance. And microcurrent is less temporary than makeup, and it can have a more dramatic effect that you can't really get easily with makeup unless you are super talented. And of course, because it goes deeper than skincare, it also does things that skincare can't. One thing I really like about microcurrent devices is that you can pretty much immediately see the sorts of effects you're going to get. It's not like something in skincare where you generally have to wait a few months to see what's happening. Whereas microcurrent, you can immediately see what's going to happen and you know what you're going to get if you keep on using it. With microcurrent devices, it's really important to stick with it. If you stop using it, then the effects are going to fade, and so you have to be consistent. I really like the Foreo Bare because I'm not very good at being consistent with things, but this makes it so much easier. It's got a really easy charging port. All you do is stick a cable in. It's a USB cable. It doesn't have like a bulky charging cradle or anything. It also has this silicone body, which makes it really easy to wipe down and keep clean and hygienic. When we're talking about the changes that happen to your skin as you get older, we can split it into two categories, intrinsic and extrinsic. Intrinsic changes happen because your body functions differently as it gets older and your skin is part of your body. These changes are largely unavoidable. The main changes we see in skin is that it gets thinner and more fragile, and you'll start to see fine wrinkles. Extrinsic changes happen because of the environment. The older you are, the longer you've been exposed to the environment. For skin, the main environmental thing that affects us is the sun, and you're probably sick of hearing it, but this is why everyone keeps on saying to wear sunscreen. The most common changes we see in skin that's been exposed to a lot of sun are deep wrinkles and crevices, age spots, scaling, and dryness. In Caucasian skin, about 80% of the signs of aging that you see are because of sun exposure. With darker skin, there's melanin, which is protective against UV light, but we still see lots of changes. And the main changes we see are to do with pigment, so this is things like age spots. So unsurprisingly, the best way to prevent these changes is using sun protection. The obvious thing to use is sunscreen, and you're looking for a sunscreen that has high UVA and UVB protection. Both of these contribute to aging, and so you're looking for a broad spectrum, high SPF sunscreen that you can happily wear every day. One study actually found that daily sunscreen use actually reversed the signs of aging. And I think this goes to show that your skin is living. It has the ability to start repairing itself as long as you protect it from getting re-attacked every day. In general, it's a good idea to wear sunscreen every day when you go outside if you're worried about these extrinsic changes in your skin. When you're indoors, there's obviously less UV. UVB doesn't penetrate glass, but depending on your situation, you can still get a large amount of UVA. If you're close to a sunny window every day, then it is still a good idea to wear sunscreen indoors. I have a video about working out, whether or not you need to wear sunscreen indoors, and I'll link that in the description. Now, when you're in a car, I guess you're technically indoors, but there are windows everywhere, so it is one of the highest exposures you can get while technically indoors. There's this really famous photo of a truck driver where one side of his face was next to a window, the other side was on the other side facing away from the closer window, and you can really see the difference when you're really close to a window. I've had some people ask me about fluorescent lights. Fluorescent lights can produce tiny amounts of UV, and this is especially the case with compact fluorescent bulbs, these are the windy looking ones. Because of all those curves, the coating inside the light bulb that usually absorbs the UV sometimes gets cracked, and so little amounts of UV come out. But it is still a really tiny amount of UV. So if you're more than 25 centimeters away from the light, if you're more than about a foot, it takes about 8 hours to get the equivalent of just over a minute of midday sun exposure from somewhere like Sydney or Melbourne. If you have a plastic diffuser over the top, like you would in a normal office fluorescent light, then you get even less UV. So for the vast majority of us, that amount of UV isn't worth worrying about. If you have a photosensitizing condition, like some types of lupus, then it could be significant. Now, one of the problems with sunscreen is that we tend to get a lot of wrinkles near our eyes first, but sunscreen near your eyes can really sting. I've been adding eye sting into my sunscreen reviews, but I found that some sunscreens that don't sting my eyes will sting other people's eyes and vice versa. In general, alcohol in sunscreens and chemical sunscreens tend to sting people's eyes a bit more. One thing I found really helpful is mineral sunscreen sticks like this one from Neutrogena. Sticks tend to run a lot less because they have a lot more waxes in them, they're a lot more water resistant, and so this can really help if you want to get sunscreen around your eyes but you don't want to risk it running into your eyes. With sunscreen, it's important to remember that it's not just your face that gets a lot of sun exposure, it's also your neck and your hands. So if you have a sunscreen that doesn't really work for your face, you can still use it up by putting it on your neck and your hands. And remember, sun protection isn't just about sunscreen, there are other things you can do as well. So for example, avoid going out into the direct sun for too long in the middle of the day when there's the most UVA and UVB. You can also use UV protective clothing like hats and gloves. I actually keep a UV protective cardigan in the car because a lot of the time I forget to take it with me, but also when I'm driving I can slip on the sleeves backwards and then put my thumbs through the thumb holes and that protects the backs of my hands. Now even if you hide from the sun, there are still those intrinsic changes. Even without sun exposure, your epidermis will thin by up to half between the ages of 30 and 80. So there are lots of other things you can use in skincare, and the main one is retinoids. Retinoids is always what dermatologists recommend. Tretinoin in particular, also known as retinoic acid or retin A, this is the gold standard ingredient, and there's tons of research to back up its effectiveness. It can help with fine and coarse wrinkles, roughness, freckles, and pigmentation. It can actually make changes to the lower layers of your skin. So it can increase the growth of skin cells in your dermis called fibroblasts, and it can increase collagen. So tretinoin is a pharmaceutical, it's usually a prescription-only drug, so if you think that might be suitable for you, go talk to a dermatologist. There are also weaker versions in cosmetics like retinol and granactive retinoid, and these tend to have less side effects. If you're introducing a retinoid into your routine, be really careful, go slower than you think you have to. If you use too much too quickly, you can have lots of side effects like dryness, redness, irritation, and stinging. I have another video on how I personally introduce Tretinoin into my routine, and that will be down below. Now, as your skin gets older, it doesn't hold onto water as well, so it tends to get thinner and dry out more easily. It also becomes more fragile, so it doesn't stand up to trauma as well, and it doesn't heal as quickly. So you'll have to treat your skin a bit more gently. So things like harsh physical exfoliants and rough washcloths probably won't be as suitable. You'll probably want to use less hot water in your routine as well, so hot water is really good at washing away the natural moisturizers that your skin produces. You'll probably also want to use more moisturizer in your routine, and I think a lot of us think of moisturizer as something that's not very active, but keeping your skin hydrated is really important in keeping it functioning correctly. One of the changes in your skin as you get older is that your skin doesn't exfoliate itself as effectively, it doesn't desquamate as well. Part of this is that your skin turnover decreases, so you're not producing skin cells as quickly, but part of it is just dehydration. When your skin is dehydrated, then it doesn't exfoliate itself correctly, and so hydrating it can really help with that. Now, if your skin still isn't exfoliating itself enough, then you might want to add in a chemical exfoliant. Alpha hydroxy acids are the chemical exfoliants with the best evidence for them for anti-aging. They speed up the skin turnover that slows down as you get older. They also help with other things as well. They can even out pigmentation, they can decrease roughness, and they can even increase collagen. There are different levels that you can go with alpha hydroxy acids as well, so something that is a leave-on chemical exfoliant won't get as deep as a professional peel. One of the issues with alpha hydroxy acids is that it can increase UV sensitivity, so if you're using these, make sure you're also using a sunscreen. There are some other anti-aging ingredients as well, in particular antioxidants, vitamin C, and peptides. There is less evidence for these, but they could be worth looking into depending on your situation. There is a lot of variability when it comes to the formulas of these though, so a good rule of thumb is to look for clinical tests on the finished formula. So this is things like before and afters and clinical studies. Now, if you're worried about pigment, then one important thing to consider is the depth of the pigment. Most skincare, especially if you're not using drug products, can only really deal with very surface level pigment. Some good ingredients for dealing with pigment are retinoids, hydroquinone, vitamin C, arbutin, kojic acid, niacinamide, and licorice extract. With extracts, be really careful because there are lots of different types of extracts and not all licorice extracts will actually help with pigment. So make sure you look for a product that actually specifies that it's for pigment. If you have deeper pigment that these skincare products aren't really helping with, or if you're not sure how deep your pigment is, then go to a professional who can diagnose your problem and help you out with that, so they can put you on a treatment plan that includes stronger treatments like lasers and peels. Wrinkles come from repeated movements as well as the condition of your skin. You can think of it like a piece of leather. Wrinkles will form when you fold that leather repeatedly. This is why you might have heard of preventative Botox. That actually stops your face from moving as much and so you don't get these folded in wrinkles. There are also wrinkles called sleep wrinkles that come from sleeping on your side or on your front, so your face basically gets smooshed up. And because we sleep for about a third of our lives, this smooshing can etch in a wrinkle in our skin. So for a lot of people, it can be worth it to train yourself to sleep on your back. Now, some people shouldn't be doing this because there might be other reasons they're not sleeping on their back, like sleep apnea. Now, this is way more serious than sleep wrinkles. And for some people, sleeping on your back just decreases your quality of sleep so much that it's not worth it. It can also have drawbacks. For people who want to try sleeping on their back, you don't have to have a special pillow for this, although it can make it a bit more convenient. You can use wedge pillows or you can use towels to try to keep your head in one spot. You can also try to use a heavier quilt that sort of holds you in place. Now for makeup, I'm still working on trying to get my concealer to sit properly, but Angie from Hot and Flashy has tons of great tips. Using a primer underneath your concealer can really help spread out the concealer and keep it from shifting into those lines. And this is a little bit counterintuitive, but using less concealer can actually help as well, because then there's less stuff that can move. With things like highlighters, it's good to avoid large particles because they tend to settle into lines and make them more obvious. So those are some of my tips for how to change your routine as you get older. Do you have any other tips? Let me know in the comments. If you liked the video, click the like and the subscribe. You can also follow me on Instagram and check out my blog for more nerdy science content. Thank you to Foreo for sponsoring this video, and I will see you next time.